Thank you all for coming. Sorry for the technical difficulty in the beginning. We are very happy to have the Zen teacher from North Carolina Zen Center with us, Teshin. Thank you. So I will give a full introduction of Teshin Roshi at 8 o'clock. When people actually sign on for the talk, there's a lot more people probably from at that time. So I will simply hand over the mic, so to say, to Teshin, and he will lead us in this period of meditation. Thank you.
So in thinking about giving a guided meditation, I thought, well, in one way, the last thing I want to do is become another voice in your head. I think we already have so many of those. This is one of the limitations of guided meditations, is they perhaps limit the way we work with our own minds. Of course, there are positives as well. So I think what I'll do tonight is keep it very minimal. And for the most part, we'll sit zazen, which is in our traditions just means seated silent meditation. So if everybody would like to participate, can begin by settling into your posture. And as I was thinking about this guided meditation, some of the images that come to mind, I've worked with my students with this. One of the images is when I was a teenager, I was in a rock band and we had a 4-track recorder. And with that kind of machine, what you would do is lay down a drum track and a bass track and a guitar track, voice, and then the 4-track player would blend them all together. So I think it's a useful metaphor or image to use for our practice tonight. Starting with the body, this is our most basic track. Settling into an upright posture, firm base, preferably if we can, having 3 points of contact, the knees and the bottom, or if we're in a chair, our feet firmly planted on the floor. And then feeling that natural curve in the lower back. Rising up. Very upright. In Zen, we talk about being taut, but not tight. So we want an attentive posture. Sternum is up, shoulders are relaxed, ears over the shoulders. I often think of the posture as one of being like our skeleton, being like a hanger, our flesh hanging off of that very relaxed draping. Chin is lightly tucked in. A lifting with the top of the head, the crown of the head. Eyes are lowered. At least some, letting some light in. When we close our eyes completely, it can be very tempting to fall asleep or to get into dreamy states. So at least having some light that can hit the eye. Tongue touching the top of the palate behind the top teeth. In the front. So this is our first track. Our second track is to work with the breathing. Begin to breathe from deep in the hara, which is this physical center 2 inches below the navel. If we tend to breathe from the chest, it tends to be a more anxious breath. So this track of the breath is beginning to regulate the nervous system, activating the parasympathetic nervous system, the rest and digest. We can't hope to do much without that basic relaxation of the mind and body. So working with the breath, we pay attention fully, inhaling through the nose, if you're able, exhaling through the mouth. And then moving to what might be a somewhat new approach for some of you. Many, of course, these first two tracks are basic to most traditions, most meditative traditions. But this third, which will tie into the talk tonight, is to drop in this gentle questioning of who. Simply repeating with the exhalation. Who. And then finally, the fourth track, which is to infuse that who with a deep questioning energy, a heart energy. Who is it who becomes anxious? Who is it that is sitting? Who is it? The very birth of our being. This kind of energy doesn't have to be verbalized. It can just be an energetic wanting to know who we are in the deepest sense. if you find your mind wandering, just return to the present moment, to these four tracks of sitting, the posture, the breath, the repetition of this one word, who, and this energetic inquiry, who. Again, as a reminder, if the mind wanders, bring it back to the present moment, to the practice, not the thoughts about the practice, but the practice itself. No need to be critical of oneself or judge one's ability to stay with it or not when we can't stay with it. But without judgment, without commenting, simply returning to the breath. And for these last, for these last few minutes, as we come towards the end of the sit, beginning to peel away those four tracks, removing the questioning, removing the repetition of who. Simply focusing on the sensation of the breath. And then perhaps even letting go of that. Just being present.
Join your palms, move and massage. Thank you for coming. Welcome. I am happy to have our guest speaker tonight, Roshi Teshin Matthew Sweger, whom I met online actually, earlier part of the year in the spring, as part of the book launch for one of my books. He was gracious to host a talk for members of his center. And there I discovered there's a lot of affinities in terms of the methods that we use, the training process. And I really felt a rapport with Teshin Roshi. So I'm very happy that he agreed to speak to our Sangha here tonight and all of you online. Just a short introduction. He, for those of you who are new, Roshi Teshin began his practice in 93 at Rochester Zen Center, which of course was founded by Philip Kapleau Roshi, one of the founding fathers of Zen tradition in the United States. He practiced for many years in residence and as a householder. In 2004, he was ordained as a Zen priest. And by 2014, after 10 years, he had completed the koan training. 2016, he received Dharma transmission. And in 2017, he took up the position as teacher at the North Carolina Zen Center, where he currently lives with his wife, Dana, and their adopted their new foster parents of a four-year-old. And he also on the side maintains a private psychotherapy practice, enjoys exploring the intersection of Dharma practice and psychodynamic psychotherapy. And he has many skills. I discovered that he's also a skilled carpenter. So he does all these things. And now he also enjoys working on his Volkswagen. So he fixes cars as well. Actually, we have a similarity there. I fix my cars too. So tonight his talk is Why You Practice Zen. Please join your palms. Thank you. Let's welcome him.
Thank you. Thanks for that introduction, Guagu. And thank you again for the invitation to speak to with your Sangha. I know I see some familiar faces from our small group here in North Carolina. So it's wonderful to connect. I think as watching one of your previous talks, you mentioned how important it is that we do this cross-pollination, you know, this Mahasangha, sort of getting out of our own little Sangha bubbles, right? So glad to be here, and want to leave, of course, room for questions at the end. So I was thinking about what to talk about, and I just kept coming back to this question of why we practice this. Part of this came up because a while back I was giving a talk to a group of students and new to practice, and talking about after sitting for half an hour, just like we did tonight, and talking about the experience of Sesshin. For people that don't know, Sesshin is the intensive retreats that we do, where we sit for, you know, anywhere between 8 and 10 hours a day. And after listening, one of the college students asked the question, why would you do this to yourself? Why? And you could pass that question off as sort of just the someone who's a little too preoccupied or judgmental or something like that. But it's a legitimate question. It really is. Why would we practice this? The obvious reason is that there are many reasons, both reasons that we're aware of and reasons that we're not aware of. You could say some people come for health reasons, blood pressure, stress relief. Some people come for a sense of community. Now, that's a good reason. I mean, many people feel alone and disconnected these days. Some people come for concentration. I once worked with another group of college students, and I was a chaplain at the University of Rochester for a little bit. And this group of students used to get together and study, but when they studied, they would sit in the Zazen posture because they knew that it helped them with their concentration. Some people come for creative thinking. So a number of my students know the story of one of my teachers who was invited by a creative thinking company who themselves were hired by a large company. And they wanted a Zen teacher to come and teach their, what turns out to be their oil engineers, how to think more creatively. So she was flown down to Mobile, Alabama, walked into a room of ExxonMobil engineers, and they were talking about how to extract more oil out of the earth. And she thought, what the hell did I get myself into here? By the end, by the way, of that workshop with those engineers, many of them had begun to rethink their choices. Some people come to practice to feel simply more grounded, more present. And, you know, some people come for addiction, for anxiety. Certainly, practices like this can help with addiction. We can become to see how the mind goes from one addiction to the next. Of course, the root addiction is what? The addiction to our thinking. Of course, there are many, many more reasons to practice, but I would say that all of these reasons, as good as they are in some ways still lacking. And the reason for that is because with all of these reasons, they're all based on this kind of investment and return mentality, and effort and reward. If I do this, then I will get that. It's an accounting system. It's like going to the gym. And I would argue that as long as there is an accounting system going on, we miss out on the true gift of practice. So then why is it that we concentrate the mind, sit for these hours and hours, years, decades? I would argue that, or maybe not argue, I would assert that the reason is because we are designed to. We are designed to. We are made to practice. Just like a fish is made to swim, or a bird is made to fly. The thing is that as human beings, we all know from our science classes that we have these giant cerebral cortexes, and these people that are looking down, you look up at your screen, these opposable thumbs. And these two things primarily give us two things. They give us space, and they give us time. Most species on this planet, this incredible planet, that is in such tragic shape now, most species are consumed from morning till night with survival. Spending every day trying to survive, to feed themselves, to keep themselves safe, to keep their young safe. And of course, on some levels, we do this as well. We have to. But with humans, it's a bit different. Our intellects, our brains, have given us this luxury of time. And out of that space, out of that time, comes all manner of possibilities. Invention, self-reflection, empathy. I suppose as well as scrolling endlessly on social media, right? Of course, again, there are people that are simply trying to hold body and soul together. And perhaps the thing that's important for us to remember is that these are people who need to learn to sit. And tragically, too often, they are the last people to learn this technology of sitting. So our brains give us space, and of course, an intellect. And when we have time and space and an intellect, these create this perfect brew to wonder and to question. Because human beings don't just look at the world and take it for granted. That's not enough for most people. We always want to go deeper than that. We always want to know what's over there. What's over there? What's beyond the moon? Why was I born? Of course, this kind of inquiry, this kind of questioning can get skewed. It turns into things like conspiracy, as we see in our country right now, this questioning mind. And all of that is born out of that same dissatisfaction with things as they are. So this questioning can be both a curse as well as a blessing. It's a blessing because our dissatisfaction is the force that compels us to wonder what's out there. But the curse, of course, is that it's difficult for us as people just to be. How many of us know how to just be? So we have this intellectual curiosity, and the difficulty with this curiosity, so to speak, is it only gets us so far, especially in the realm of spirituality or practice. Back in Japan, before Zen had really gotten a foothold in the West, if you wanted to learn about Zen, you were simply, you'd maybe go to a monastery and they wouldn't give you any explanation. You would simply be shown into the Zendo, or perhaps more accurately, the Zendo outside of the Zendo. You would not be allowed to sit with the monks. And you were just told to sit down and breathe. No explanation. In the 1950s, maybe a little earlier than that, Yasutani Roshi, one of the founders of our school of Zen and the line that I'm in, began to offer introduction to Zen workshops and to lay people primarily. And he knew that people needed more to really understand the practice. And so as a part of the workshop, what he would do is he would take a ballpoint pen and he would hold it up to his audience and he would say, "This pen is your mind." And then he would take his finger and he would point to the very ball tip. He would say, "But this tiny portion is the intellect. The rest of this pen is untapped by most people." So you can only go so far with the intellect. When you rely on the intellect too much, especially in the realm of spiritual practice, you end up risking becoming philosophical. There are countless books on philosophy. They fill whole libraries the sheer volume of philosophical books, even Zen books, the sheer volume tells you that we still haven't really worked this one out. Too much philosophy is simply the exhausted intellect trying to exert itself. For most of us, the intellect can only go so far before it gets tired. It runs out of fuel, so to speak. It's like an airplane, and it needs to land. And oftentimes, when the intellect runs out of fuel, it lands on the runway of myth and belief. This is where it wants to put down. It's an easy place. It's a comfortable place. You see this all the time in people. I think of people in their 20s. They encounter ideas in college, become inquisitive, and life experience begins to take a different dimension. They begin to question their, maybe even earlier than 20s, maybe teens, they begin to question their parents' religion, their beliefs, their myths, right? And they feel kind of free with that, intellectually and experientially. But over time, as people begin to have families, moving into their 30s, into their 40s, they begin to either return to their parents' religion or begin to look for their own landing field. Sometimes they want to give something to their kids to believe in, something, some kind of story. It's easier to buy into myth, to rest and relax into that belief system, to compromise, to put the questioning that we once had as children to the side, that questioning that once fueled our exploration of life. And then that complacency can set in. And this is a danger in Zen practice as well. Complacency is, I think, perhaps one of the top forces that is a practice killer. In my opinion, perhaps we could, well, I would, if I was in charge, I would maybe add it to the list of the traditional five hindrances of the Buddha that the Buddha outlined, you know, the list of torpor, laziness, of doubt, of restlessness, of ill will and desire, all these forces that can really derail our practice. So complacency, I would say, is one of these strong forces that can derail us, settle into belief. So then, if we don't practice Zen to believe, then why? I would say that we practice in order to refuel the plane of inquiry, to get it back into the air, to press into the unknown, to resist that temptation to settle. Many people come to practice for that reason, with hoping to refuel. That's what they're looking for, hoping to reinvigorate the mind of a child. And yet even with that, it does become tempting to settle. Even what some people do is want to settle into Buddhist belief. There's one for you, which may be more appealing than the myths of our childhood, because Buddhist beliefs in many ways line up more with maybe our affinity with science. Maybe it just makes sense to us. And there can be comfort in that. And then we become to identify as a Buddhist. Oh, identity. There we go. I am now a Buddhist. Another tempting place to land aside from belief is this runway of calm, of tranquility. I mean, it's true, we do need, most of us anyway, need a little tranquility in our life. It's not to be discounted. But this tranquility can become another trap. As I was thinking about this today, I remembered one of the traditional stories from Zen, and maybe I won't get the master right. I think it may have been Chaozhou or Joshu, but I remember hearing, and it may be even one of the koans, but a student asked this master, what happens when there no thought arises? And the master said, get rid of that. And the student said, well, there's nothing to get rid of. And he said, well, fine, carry it out then. If you want to hold on to quietude, fine. But that's not what Zen is about. A good teacher does their best to encourage their students to not settle into quietude. Many masters have warned against that desert of calm that so easily can take a foothold. Like samadhi, of course, samadhi, this one pointed concentration where even the smallest thought disappears, these wonderful states of just beautiful states of quiet can take hold. They are important, of course, to become experienced with, but nothing to rest in. And so often what a teacher will do is say, yes, that's important, yes, but what else? Go deeper, deeper than that calm. So in our tradition, one of the tools, and this is kind of what we were doing in the beginning today for those of you who were in the guided meditation, one of the tools that we employ to get us, help us take off again is this practice of what are called koan. Koan. Or in, I think in Chinese, maybe you could help me with this, I think it's gongan, something like that. Okay. Which of course just means a public case, like a case in a court that's a precedent, something a judge looks to help them decide law cases when they come across their bench, a precedent. So koans are these short dialogues or interactions or sometimes just questions from the tradition. History, sometimes between a monk and a master, or sometimes, again, like just a question. And they're given to a student to sit with, to solve. Now, solve not as in problem versus solution, okay? It's not an answer in the traditional sense that a koan is looking or a teacher is looking for when they give a student a koan. No, koans are complete in themselves from the beginning. The job of the student is not to solve it in that way, but rather to embody the koan. One must become the koan. To enter it so thoroughly that there is no gap between them and the koan. And if one works on one of these, then demonstrating that their understanding to their teacher. In our tradition, we do that one-on-one with a teacher, student. And so koans are often very paradoxical. And what this does is helps us leap beyond the intellect. They're not in the territory of the intellect, although the intellect wants to assert itself. What these koans do actually is hook the intellect. Because we're used to going for the tools that are most familiar in life. That's what we do when we face a problem. We're taught to answer questions. We're taught to raise our hand in school. Even if we don't have the answer, we're taught, raise your hand to give our answer. But again, koans demand that we merge with the koan. So I thought we could take a quick look at one to get an idea of how these work. Of course, all of you sat with the root koan, who are you? Sometimes we take out the who and just say, what are you? There are other koans, there's many. Some say, you know, in our tradition, we work with many hundreds of koans. But this koan is from a book of 48, from a book called the Mumon, the Gateless Gate, the Wumen Guan in Chinese, book of 48 koans. And this is case number 5. It's called Kyogen's Man Up a Tree. And I'll just read the case so you can get a sense of how these work, what they do. It goes like this. Master Kyogen, that's his Japanese name. These are Chinese masters, and I don't speak Chinese, so I tend to fall back onto the Japanese versions. Kyogen said, it's like a man up a tree hanging from a branch by his teeth. His arms can't reach a bough, and his feet can't grasp the tree. Along comes another person down below and looks up at him and says, what is the meaning of Bodhidharma's coming from the West? Which, by the way, in Zen speak, just is, what is the truth? If the man up the tree doesn't answer, he fails the questioner. But if he does answer, he loses his life. At that time, how should the man answer? How should the student answer? Now, immediately, what we do is something like, well, how could he get into such a stupid position to begin with? That's impossible, right? This is what we do. How did he get up there? Of course he could reach a branch. If he's hanging with his teeth, he could have reached that branch. So this is what we do. We have to put all that aside if we're going to work on a koan. So then the mind goes something like, well, there's only two possible answers. He either answers or he doesn't. Well, there's another way. There's another way. Not A and not B. Not right, not wrong, not good, not bad. And none of those other prepositional opposites that we so get entangled in life. And that way is what the student in Zen has to discover and embody for themselves. So we might ask, well, then, again, why would we want to do this to ourselves? It sounds like torture. Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, life is full of paradox. I mean, how many of you know where you came from? One day you just woke up and you had consciousness. There's a paradox for you. Where are you going to go when you die? There's a paradox, especially if we don't fall back on myth. We all have these natural questions over as we become so-called educated in life. And yet these paradoxes are still there. And these paradoxes are what cause much of the anxiety in our life. And so koans work with paradox. They work with uncertainty. They address it directly. They bring it right front and center and say, work with it. Don't ignore it. Don't just breathe through life. Don't distract yourself through life. Resolve this matter. And so this territory that koans explore is this territory that is underneath, so to speak, the thinking mind. My teacher used to say that the mind is like a ruler. He would pull up a ruler and he would say the front part, you know, the part with all the markings, the inches or the centimeters and all that. He said, this is one part of the mind, but then he would flip it around and say, there's this whole other side where there are no markings. That is the territory that koans expose, that questioning, even it doesn't have to be a koan, but deep questioning expose. Sometimes I refer to it as this ancient one. In Zen, it sometimes is called our original face before our parents were born. So it's ancient in a relative sense, but it also has no age in a more absolute sense. There's another paradox for you. And this original one is always manifesting in this present moment. And so koans etch away at that veneer of the thinking mind that stands between us in our original face. And so this is the purpose, especially the first koan that one works on. I worked on my first koan for 6 years. It's not something that, you know, of course, many people take much shorter than I did, some longer, because it's not something that you can just, it's not like rubbing off a lottery ticket, scratching with a coin for a second or two. But after that first insight, that initial insight, then there are many more koans to help widen that experience. Because in our tradition, we believe that these small experiences can help, but then we need to widen that. Because the mind tends to close up again. It tends to revert back to habit. And so we have this whole tradition that helps us to pull open, to loosen those threads of that tightly knit clothing of self and thinking. Koan work always happens, by the way, within the context of a student-teacher relationship. And this is a very important point. It's important because the teacher us. And if they haven't, and they're trying to work on koans with you, I would advise not to get into that, because otherwise it can be the blind leading the blind. And as one progresses through the koans, the student becomes more free, more from that dualistic kind of thinking that really, and here's the point, is at the root of our suffering. That's the point, is this dualistic thinking, this clinging mind is based in duality, self and other. And so it's a long process, or it can be, because we have deep habit energies. Some koans work on self and other versus other. Some koans versus work on words versus no words. Some koans work on morality. Some get into traditional Buddhist teachings and others not. When we stick with this kind of training point, going back to the beginning, is we refuel our plane over and over again. And when we do, we have a real opportunity. It's all about exploration, in my view, that unmapped territory of the mind. Now, both the relative mind and the absolute mind. The relative mind of our habits, of our psychology, of our all those forces that we all struggle with, that's important too. And ultimately to see that that absolute, that ancient one, and this relative one, that they are not two. So all of these reasons, from the minor reasons like health and de-stressing, working on our psychology, to the deepest reasons of exploring the mind, they're all reasons to practice. There's nothing wrong with using Zen for health reasons, really not to de-stress. But I would just leave you with this. When we just simply stop there, I would argue that we're using a very sophisticated airplane to cross the street. And this is the danger that practice is encountering in America. It's just becoming kind of a way to de-stress. So I think I've talked way too long. So I'm gonna, I guess, turn it over back to Guagu, and you tell me what's next.
I encourage all of you present here, also the online community, to ask questions. How to fly the plane? How not to use the plane to cross the street? let's see if people here have questions. And at the same time,
I see it here.
Okay.
So it says, Teshin, during the complacency in practice, what strategies do you recommend to surmount any complacency? Good question. Well, I would say one of the things is to work with a teacher. Like I mentioned in the talk, the role of a teacher is to be both supportive but also challenging, to help you sort of get out of that complacency. It's sometimes a little worrying when I don't hear from students for a long time. It's like, what happened to you, right? I think most teachers would agree. I want to hear from you. I want to meet with you. I want to practice the Dharma with you. And so, practicing alone is fine, but I think the electricity happens when we're in relationship. That's where things come more alive. So that's one thing, is to work with a teacher to keep it alive. Also, of course, What many of my students know is that it's helpful to have inspiring reading. Kapleau Roshi used to say in that good Zen book is one that inspires us to eventually close it and go sit. So we have to be skillful with ourselves. We have to know ourselves enough. What is it that gets us into that complacent mindset? What is it that puts us to sleep, so to speak? And how are we gonna, what are we gonna do about that? Right? What are we gonna do about it? So that's just a couple of thoughts.
Thank you. Is there another question?
Other questions?
Maria has a question.
My question is, how does psychotherapy intersect Zen practice? And I guess I'm thinking about, it seems like many of us come to practice and we're not feeling very good about ourselves. And I know psychotherapy works with that, but I was just wondering, since you have both of those, I guess, skill sets, I'd say.
Right. Yeah, as a young man, in my very early college years, before I came to practice, I was highly anxious. I mean, racked with anxiety, totally paralyzed by anxiety. And coming to practice was the wish to, in many ways, to get beyond that. And it helped. But I can honestly say it wasn't until I really engaged in therapy. And when I say therapy, I'm talking about experiential psychotherapy, not necessarily just sitting back and having a chat with a therapist. Oftentimes that can be helpful for support. But if we want to really uproot some of the causes of some of our difficulties, emotional difficulties, we need something deeper than that. So the type that I practice and recommend is deep experiential therapy that works with the causes, not just the surface level. You know, we're not trying to paper it over with positive thinking and that kind of thing. That can help somewhat, but uprooting. And so I think I tend to think of psychotherapy as just one more tool in the toolbox. It's not really a separate thing. We're here just to get to the bottom of who we are, whatever it takes. So this, I really don't anymore see them as separate things. The Dharma and psychotherapy, they're just different ways of getting at that. Now, of course, each has its limits. You know, I see people that practice earnestly in the Dharma for many, many years, if not decades, and still struggle with emotional blocks, with painful ways of relating to other people and to themselves, self-critical thoughts. A lot of people use spiritual practice to try to bypass their internal emotional life. And oftentimes, because they're dealing with trauma, and as understandable as that wish is to bypass, it really misuses the practice. And so I find that I try to help students face what is the fear that they have, the difficult feelings that arise, the anxieties. And then one is freed up to be more engaged in the practice directly. And I think I forget who it was, maybe it was Jack Engler who said, or maybe Mark Epstein said, you have to be somebody before you can be nobody. Meaning you have to resolve, for many of us, not everybody needs psychotherapy, don't misunderstand me, but many of us need to really firm up in a very healthy way our sense of self before we can really truly let go. Otherwise, it's just another defense, and practice can be misused as a defense, trying to check out. You know, people talk about detachment. We hear this word detachment in Buddhism, and of course, that's a misuse of the word. when we think of it as checking out, blissing out, right? I prefer the word non-attachment rather than detachment. So.
There's one online.
It says, Teshin, if I'm not mistaken, a cornerstone of Zen is the abandonment of notions of good and bad phenomenon, so to speak. How does one maintain a sense of urgency in practice without viewing practice as good and not practicing as bad? Okay, good. Or not good. I do this in my own life, is to try to catch myself when I turn to good and bad. And I prefer what the Buddha used, which was skillful versus unskillful, to take it out of the realm of judgment, more or less. But to really honestly just look at what is skillful for what we want, and what is unskillful, then it becomes less laden with that kind of judgment. So the Buddha said, if you're going to have a desire, the one desire that's okay is the desire for awakening. And I think this is important, that he knew that we have to use the mind to, we have to use what we have. And, you know, he was aware of that desire is what causes suffering, but then we can also use that as a tool to help us free ourselves. So bodhicitta, this wish, this desire to save all beings, is so important to cultivate in oneself, to get in touch with. What is it that we want, to clarify your intention for practice, and then to become skillful at what is the best practice for that, to work with a teacher to help us clarify what practice is the most appropriate medicine for the disease that we are trying to cure.
Okay. In daily life, what do you recommend, for someone practicing koans, to continue their koan practice and bring the same koan up, or to see the paradoxes that they are faced with, in a conflictual staff meeting or working with the situation at hand? Should we use our intellect to really see the paradox and just reflect on it, or how do you deal with paradox in daily life as practice?
Yeah, good question. Of course, like I said in the talk, that life is full of paradox and difficulty, really. I mean, what we're talking about with paradox is that when the mind encounters something that it really just means not making sense, something doesn't make sense to us, right? Mm-hmm. It doesn't fit in with our worldview. It doesn't fit in with what we want. One of my teachers used to say, what you want is irrelevant. especially deep in retreat, he would say that, and it would be just so aggravating. God, why do you have to, but that's true. What we want in many ways is irrelevant, because the world doesn't operate that way. And so, yes, we want to become flexible and to approach these things and to embrace them. So in our tradition, if someone has that wish to work on a koan, then we are encouraged to sort of tunnel or focus all of our questioning, whether it's because we had some disruption in a relationship or at work or whatever, to take some of that or take all of it and funnel it into the koan itself, to really to focus it like a laser. Right. And that can become helpful, because then that's the fuel for the practice. Today didn't go well, I didn't get what I wanted in that relationship. And here I find myself again. What am I going to do about that? Well, I focus that back into the practice. So I fold that into my practice. Okay. It's like this, like a kneading dough. We fold it in and work it in over and over again. Okay. So that's one way. And then, of course, the other way is just watch the reaction in mind. You know, when, how is it that we usually deal with paradox? Well, oftentimes we get angry, we become fearful, and we become reactive. And these are the states of mind that create pain, suffering for ourselves and others. And so when we find ourselves in reactive states of mind, there's the opportunity. There is the opportunity for practice right there. We don't need to deny that we're angry. One thing I don't want students to do is to say, well, I'm not angry, I'm spiritual. Like just putting on that nice, happy face and pretending everything is okay and all that fake kind of spiritual stuff. So we acknowledge, yeah, I'm angry. And then we try to work with it to let it go as quickly as we can. And the way to let it go is to fully experience it. Then it doesn't stick around. A free person is somebody who can just, whatever it is, can come in, we can experience it, and then it goes. We don't linger in thought about it, create stories about it. That's what keeps things stuck, is the story making. So when paradox comes into our life and it stirs all that stuff up in us, we notice the reactivity, we let go of reactivity by fully becoming whatever we're feeling, and then there's no problem.
Thank you.
There's a question from Anne Marie that says, do you rely on commentary to figure things out in the koan study? Curious about the 6-year time process.
You rely on commentary. I'm not sure what you mean by commentary. It could mean a different number of different things, commentary. Certainly, what comes to mind is the commentary that masters append to the koans. Oftentimes, there's different masters that will comment on the koans. One of our traditions is to give talks on koans, and that's considered a commentary on each koan. I found them very helpful in my own training to hear from one of my teachers about the koans, or to get clarification I still listen to Dharma talks to get inspiration from other teachers. I still actually work with another teacher, even though I have permission to teach. I think it's helpful to stay in relationship with a teacher after you're a teacher. To work with somebody that's inspiring and also challenging. So that 6-year time period was certainly one of exploration and just going to a lot of retreats. That's what I did, is I just went to as many as I could. That's what I would recommend for anybody, is to go to as many retreats as possible, to sit daily, to keep the practice front and center in your life as much as you can, to learn to take the koan off the mat, so to speak, in the zendo, and into your life, to wake up with it, to go to bed with it. It kind of gets under your skin after a while. Anybody that's worked on a koan knows it's designed to kind of be like a little invasive species that gets in there and it doesn't really let you go. So that's good. That's good. If we're aggravated by the koan, that's good. You could say, well, that doesn't sound good to me. Well, because we are doing this disruptive process, practice is disrupting the status quo. So whatever it takes for you to disrupt the status quo. Okay. So for me, it took me 6 years to have some kind of real disruption of the status quo. For other people, it takes 20 years. For other people, it takes no time at all. And some people never practice formally and still have that disruption. Kapleau Roshi famously worked with a man who came back from Vietnam in the early 70s, and he was dropped off in New York City, and he had never practiced before in his life. But he came back with this deep questioning. One minute he was in the jungles of Vietnam killing people as a Marine, and the next minute he was on the streets of New York City watching people sip cups of coffee. And that's a paradox. And he thought, what is real? And he was so consumed with that question that he would walk around and apparently, which is ran right into a light post and bam, had this sudden awakening experience and came to meet Kapleau Roshi later in his life and explain this situation. And Kapleau said, yeah, what you had was what we call a kensho, or awakening experience. And it changed his life. So we don't have to practice formally, but the point is to, whatever your natural question is to learn to channel that, to keep it front and center.
Thank you for your talk. You know, very often the presentation of the Japanese tradition of koan practice is, as you mentioned tonight, to merge with the koan, to be one with it. Seldom, however, do I hear the sense of wonderment. Maybe it's just a matter of language, but in the Chan tradition, the whole point is to generate a sense of not knowing, the sense of wonderment that can be small, or it could be all-consuming, which everything just collapses into this. And yet, one's able to, you know, at least in retreat setting or in simple life settings, able to sustain that for long time or short, but the key point is the sense of wonderment. And so I was wondering if you can say something about this, or what does it mean when you say to be one with the koan?
Yeah, that's a great point. In the Japanese tradition, it can often come across as very martial, very kind of stern, and very kind of, you know. And when I was in China practicing, I practiced there for a little while at a monastery called Bailinzi, in under a Chan teacher. And when I was traveling in China, whatever master I would meet, they would inevitably say to us as a group, they would say, oh, you're from the Japanese tradition. Because they could tell we would hold ourselves in this kind of stern manner and have this seriousness to us. And they said, God, you know, you Japanese Zen people need to learn to relax. And it's true. You know, practice is a matter of the heart. It's a matter of becoming more childlike, of becoming more in touch. I hope that came across somewhat, at least in my talk, of touching back into that sense of questioning, of wonder, of like a child again. We have the beauty and honor of fostering this four-year-old, and she's just filled with questioning, why this and why that? What's that about? And it's like, yeah, okay, that's where it's at. That's where it's at. So practice is not, it doesn't have to be about conquering a koan. It can be about embracing a koan, totally embracing with love. It can be totally just wanting that intimacy, you know, whatever energy we need to bring to it, we want to learn to uncover. So for some people, that will be different for each person, I feel. Some people need that more. I'm not putting up with this anymore, this kind of no-nonsense approach. And for some, that doesn't work at all. It becomes more confirming of this kind of punitive side of us that's not helpful. And so if I see that in a student, I might suggest they work in a different way. Like you say, more of a kind of a wow. Just, and everybody who's been to retreat has these moments of wonder where we, you know, for me, it was the first time it happened, or maybe one of the first times it was, when the teapot was passed down at breakfast and coming out of the zendo, and it came to me, and I grabbed the teapot, and as I grabbed it, I had no idea what it was. All conception dropped away, and I sat there looking at the teapot with its reflection of the morning light in the teapot and going, what the hell is this thing? You know, just total wonder. And then I felt the mind grasp it. What is this? What is it? Panic. Oh God, I gotta know. You know, and the guy next to me is like, pass the damn teapot, would you? You know, right? So the mind wants to grasp and to know. And as we practice, we learn to just become comfortable without knowing and just stay in that state of wonder and openness. And I think this is one of the benefits of koan training as well. As long as we don't go after answers. You know, in my early koan training, I was always more consumed with trying to please my teacher and give the right answer and hope for approval. But that was another shadow side that I had to work on in therapy, was seeing the teacher as a father figure and wanting him to for approval, you see, and that can corrupt the process. So we want to learn those things about ourselves, and that will help us return to this openness.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Well, thank you, everybody, and thank you, Blaga, for the opportunity to speak with you. And it's been great. So I hope we can do it again at some point.
I hope so, too. For those of you present and those of you who are on the Zoom community, if you wish to explore more of Roshi Teshin's teachings, please go to the website for the North Carolina Zen Center. And also, I encourage you to support these teachings. Thank you. We will have a link posted to the ways that you can support the center. Thank you. Have a good night. Bye-bye.